First of all, thank you for the invitation. It is not that common to deliver a talk about polarization. Although if gamma ray bursts are still a hot topic in modern astrophysics. The problem, of course, everybody knows. Usually, talks about polarization are just the last before coffee breaks in conferences, and I guess this means something. However, I really hope today, I try to be as didactic as possible. I'm not assuming that you are expert in gamma ray burst physics or anything like that. I will try to show you with some simple examples, with the toy modeling, although of course mentioning more advanced analysis, why in this specific field and in general polarimetry is one of the most powerful diagnostic tools we have. I could in principle begin to mention the so many known phenomena able to produce a polarization, or phenomena where a polarimetric analysis can tell us a lot about emission processes, how light interacts, photons interact during their flight, and so on and so on. But possibly much more interesting is an example. This plot is comes from a paper by Elena Rossi in 2004. I usually try to quote the very first paper where somebody is introduced, although there are, of course, later often papers discussing the same thing. But I will show again this plot later. Please don't be bothered by the details now. There will be time to discuss them. What I want to show is a typical case in gamma ray burst physics. In the upper plot, I don't know, maybe you see my cursor, but it is not that important. You see predictions for the afterglow. I will later let you know what the afterglow is in case a few of us don't know. You see the predictions, this is the R band in the optical, for several different models with different ingredients and so on. Again, please don't be, let's not pay attention to the details now. As you can see, essentially, the predictions are almost indistinguishable with any real data, with real signal-to-noise limited data. However, if you go to the bottom panel, you see the prediction for polarization. And although I'm not now discussing the detail, as I said, you can see that the prediction can be and are widely different depending on the specific case. This is one case where polarimetry can tell us a lot about the physics that is going on. Although, of course, it is true, it is always true that doing polarization, when we work in polarimetry, the photons are never enough. You need the large collecting areas and other specific tools to carry out a proper analysis. Although, together with a lot of statistics, good statistics, because polarimetry can be very tricky. However, for the most expert among us, please don't get bored, but it is just the case to remind us what gamma ray bursts are. Observationally speaking, you know, gamma ray bursts have been discovered in the 60s by surveillance satellites. And indeed, it is a nice story to tell to, I mean, common people for conferences in libraries or in clubs of people fond of astronomy, because it is a sort of a spy story. But after the discovery, for about 30 years, we didn't learn much more Although there were people working in the field that like to say that there were more models than events, actually. Things changed considerably in the 90s when a massive observatory was launched by NASA. It is the Compton Gamma Ray Observatory, and one of its instruments, BATSY, was able to collect gamma ray burst for a few years, and the plot that you can see on upper right, in my opinion, is one of the most amazing ever, because you have circles that are the position uncertainties for a few thousand gamma ray bursts. Colors are coding the fluence, the time integrated flux, and you see that essentially the distribution is absolutely isotropic. You don't see any signature of a galactic structure or something like that. This is one very good example of the cosmological principle of homogeneity on large scale. And as you probably all know, it also means that the gamma ray bursts are coming from cosmological distances. There are could be caveats about this conclusion, but let me please skip them. They are not important now. If they are coming from cosmological distances, they are extremely energetic. And the isotropic energy, the energy assuming that the emission is totally isotropic, is comparable to the rest mass of a solar mass star. We now know that the energy is lower because the gamma ray bursts are not isotropic. It's comparable to energetic supernovae, essentially. Although if most of the emission comes in a few minutes or hours compared to typical supernova where you have emission for a month, essentially. Observationally speaking, we also have at least two flavors of a gamma ray burst. We have the so-called short gamma ray burst because the prompt emission, the high energy emission, lasts less than 2 seconds, let's say, but it can be also a fraction of a second. And we have the long gamma ray burst where the emission can last much longer, typically 20 seconds, but also minutes or more in a few cases. For polarization, everything I'm going to say is just related to the long gamma ray burst category. When I say gamma ray burst, now on, I'm only referring to the long gamma ray burst. This is simply because it was very difficult so far to carry out observations, polarimetric observations for short gamma ray bursts. This happens because they are less common compared to their longer siblings. It depends on the instruments detecting the gamma ray burst, but for instance, for SWIFT, something like 10-15% of the gamma ray bursts are short, and on average, they are fainter. And again, if you need a lot of photons to derive reliable polarimetric measurements, this can be a problem. So putting these two factors together, so far, after all these years, we do not have yet good measurements during the evolution of a short gamma ray burst. However, it is quite intriguing to see that even if these two categories are attributed to two different progenitors, families, and we have good observational evidence for that, the short gamma ray bursts are supposed to be generated by the coalescence of neutron stars. We had a very spectacular confirmation of this idea 3 years ago when the optical counterpart of a gravitational wave event was discovered, the only one so far, actually. And the long gamma ray bursts are associated to the collapse of a massive star. We still don't know exactly which massive stars are going to generate a gamma ray burst, but we know that because for several events, we also observed an associated supernova, a peculiar supernova, with a high expansion velocities, a lot of energy, they are typically labeled hypernovae. Again, please don't, I have no time, of course, to discuss the details, and probably you are not that interested, but just to establish a common terminology, please let me say a few words about what we think gamma ray bursts, physically speaking, are. Essentially, we have a phenomenon, the coalescence of two neutron stars, the collapse of a massive star, generating a lot of energy in a small volume. And depending on the conditions, an outflow, an ultra-relativistic outflow generates. Typically, you have leptons, photons, and a tiny fraction of baryons. Otherwise, you quickly thermalize. This outflow needs not to be homogeneous. You can have internal inhomogeneities. And if this happens, it's like if you have different subshells traveling with different gamma factor. The gamma factor, the Lorentz factor of this outflow could be of the order of 100 or even much more, depending on the specific cases. And if you have inhomogeneities, you can have what we call the internal shocks. And when you have a shock, you are generating synchrotron emission typically, but the emission process could be even different. And essentially, any pulse that you see in the prompt emission, it's typically related to a specific shock. Much later from the progenitor, 1,000 times later, you have now essentially an expanding shell. Typically, the shell can be thin or thick, and physics can be different. But again, this is not now very important for us. You have this shell expanding with a Lorentz factor of roughly 100. And you are beginning to interact with the circumburst medium, the interstellar medium around the progenitor. Again, depending on the density profiles and other details, you are generating shocks, very efficient shocks that we call external shocks. And you are converting kinetic energy to radiation. And this radiation is the afterglow, what we call the afterglow. So, observationally speaking and physically speaking, we have two separated phenomena that can be related, but they are also studied independently. We have the internal shocks that are generating the gamma ray burst proper, the high energy pulse that we measure with the high energy satellites. And then we have the afterglow. As I said before, the prompt emission, as we call it, lasts just a few seconds, depending on the specific category. The afterglow can last much longer, depending on the energy. We observe the afterglow from almost the TeV energy. For instance, a recent exceptional discovery by the MAGIC telescope, down to the radio. In the radio, the afterglow can last months or if not years before it becomes undetectable. In the high energy, typically you have a few hours at most. Anyway, just to simplify and to clarify the view for those of you not confident with this category of sources, essentially the time evolution of a gamma ray burst can be sketched as in this plot. You have the prompt emission, the time scale is a logarithmic, of course. You have the prompt emission, you have a decay that can be very steep at the beginning, then you can have a plateau. This happens in a few minutes, typically. Then you have this regular afterglow, and eventually the decay can steepen after what we call the jet break. All these things will be mentioned later. We have polarimetric observations during the prompt emission, mainly in the high energy regime. With the optical, we have a polarimetric observation during the early afterglow, a few minutes, and up to an hour, let's say. Then we have a lot of observations now in the late afterglow, in the optical mainly, but we are beginning to have something in the radio, and even in the late afterglow, later afterglow, after the jet break. Studying the time evolution of the events, of course, even in polarimetry, could tell us a lot about the physics. Now, let's go quickly to the point. Why we could expect some polarization from a gamma ray burst? Now, you can find hundreds of papers discussing the details. It's quite curious how typically a niche technique like polarimetry attracted a great attention by the theoreticians in the last two decades, let's say. I can mention two general categories of ideas that I still hold, although they have been refined during the years. Essentially, if you the photons that we observe from a gamma ray burst are coming, let's think to that now we are observing the afterglow jet, just because it is simpler to visualize. We have a shock that is forming, and shocks implies that you have magnetic fields that can be locally generated and amplified, or could also be already pre-existing some large-scale order magnetic fields. It depends on the models that you are studying. But in any case, if you are generating the magnetic fields locally, you are you essentially have magnetic domains that are typically casually disconnected. So one is independent of each other. And if you are observing part of the emitting regions, I will clarify this idea later, you see a few, there can be many of these domains, but they can have magnetic fields directions independent of each other. On a large scale, the magnetic field can be highly tangled. So you see maybe a very high polarization for the photons coming from a specific magnetic domain where magnetic fields are ordered, because if the emission, as it actually it is a synchrotron emission in under ideal conditions, can give you something like 60-70% polarization. But in real astrophysical sources, you see many domains, you cannot resolve the source at this level with any existing and future telescope. And you see a mix, a sort of random mix that gives you a lower polarization up to 10%, but it can be much lower. And even the position angle can change, because this is a dynamic scenario. During the evolution, the magnetic domains can change, and you see, you expect a change of the position angle. Another idea, there are connections, but it is essentially independent, was developed by first by Gabriele Ghiselini and Davide Lazzati, and one day later appeared on the archive, the AstroPH, a paper by Rem Sari reporting essentially the same physical scenario. And here, polarization is due to the geometry of the event, together with a few ingredients. Now I will spend some time describing this scenario in a very simple way, because it is very interesting and gives us a very powerful diagnostic tool that we try to apply with the real observations. Essentially, let's go back in time, 20 years ago, roughly, and we have the very first discovery of polarization from gamma ray burst afterglow. The afterglow is labeled with the OT, optical transient, in the plot, and we detected together with a competitor team something like 2% polarization. 2% polarization for astrophysical sources, for real astrophysical sources, is really a lot. Typically, the polarization we have to deal with are a fraction of a percent. And so it is a very solid measurement. The measurements we are carried out with a VLT that was very recently, a few months before, became become operational. And this is the light curve for the afterglow in different bands. You see the very typical achromatic behavior and steepening. And the observations were carried out just a little bit before the steepening, essentially, or close, very close to the steepening. Now, how can we put together these factors, the major polarization and the afterglow, the light curve evolution that we see here? Let's try to imagine what could mean to observe an afterglow, a shock front, more correctly. If we are observing an outflow, a beamed outflow, so a jet, let's imagine it's a sort of a conical jet with a given opening angle, we have a shock that forms, and from the observer point of view, however, we see anytime we have a special relativity, things are never very simple. So we have to think a little bit about it. But we see probably not just a hot spot, the shock front of the conical jet, but probably the center of the jet is dimmer because given that the photons that we receive from the center are emitted later, let's remember that this emitting region is traveling with a gamma factor of 100 or so, and the photons that we receive from the ring, from the border of the jet, were emitted just a little bit before, and so they are coming from a stage when the afterglow was brighter. So essentially, more than a spot, if we could ideally have a telescope with infinite resolution, we should see a sort of a bright ring. If this is the case, we do not expect in any case polarization, even if the emission process, synchrotron, is able to produce locally very highly polarized photons. We don't see any polarization because the source is very symmetric and everything cancels out. However, as I mentioned before, this is this should be a dynamical view. The afterglow are evolving quickly in time. What happens? At the very beginning, you know, if you remember something about spatial relativity, if we have this source traveling at the gamma factor of 100 or whatever it is, we can only see a fraction of this source, even if it were spherical, a spherical source expanding isotropically. We can only see a fraction of this source with an opening angle of 1 out gamma. This is the relativistic beaming. So we see only part of the source. At the beginning, gamma is so high that we see a small part of the source. We are not able to infer if the source is a physical jet. We have to consider the physical beaming and the relativistic beaming. These are two different facts. And at the beginning, we don't know if we are looking at a jet or just a spherical shell expanding. And with time, we have a deceleration, as I mentioned before. So the emission is a faint. You have a lowering of the emission, of the brightness of the emission. But given that gamma is decreasing, you are enlarging the opening angle of your view. So the two facts can partly compensate, and you have a mildly decaying emission. After a while, when gamma is low enough, unless sorry, when gamma is low enough, your opening angle from the perspective of the observer can become larger than the physical opening angle of the jet that you are observing. So you are missing part of the emission surface compared to the spherical case. And now you see a much steeper decay. This is the steepening that I mentioned before, and the time when this happens is called the jet break. In this cartoon, it is just very sharp. In the reality, it is not, of course, but the idea is essentially correct. Measuring the jet break time is one of them, again, one of a very powerful diagnostics, because knowing the jet break time, you can measure the opening angle, the physical opening angle of the jet, and in turn, you can estimate the real energetics of the event. Now, another piece of evidence. This comes from papers of the 80s, actually, and the idea is old, but it's still old. It was developed, I guess, in the field of blazar astrophysics. If you have a co-moving cubic area of plasma, and you have a shock, you are generating magnetic fields that are typically highly tangled, as I mentioned before. However, from the observer point of view, the shock front, what is in the co-moving isotropic, from the observer point of view, you have a strong compression in the direction perpendicular to the shock front propagation. If this happens, and if you are looking at the shock front from face on, you still see a highly tangled magnetic field. But if you are observing, in principle, let's say imaging, to observe the shock front from normal direction, perpendicular direction, you should see a very compressed emitting region, and magnetic fields line are unavoidably more aligned. You see a much more ordered magnetic field. Why this is important? Again, I'm referring to the original paper by Gabriele and Davide. And essentially, this is what happens. Let's assume that we have a relativistic fireball, the outflow that I mentioned before, with a given opening angle, theta C or whatever it is. It is the upper panel. Unless you are observing the event exactly on the cone axis, this is, of course, highly unlikely. And if you are seeing the event within the cone axis, otherwise you don't see the gamma ray burst at all, and you are receiving photons from the shock front, of course. However, given that the source is propagating with a gamma of 100 or so, it is ultra relativistic, you are also receiving, for relativistic aberration, photons that are in the co-moving frame are emitted at normal angles, perpendicular to the shock front. You are observing these photos. Given that we know already that the photons emitted when you see the outflow are typically highly polarized if the emission process is a synchrotron, but given that you see many magnetic domains, you mix everything and you do not expect any polarization, the photons emitted at normal angles actually are typically much more polarized, because they are generated from areas with a much more ordered magnetic field. Therefore, you put everything together, and the polarization that we think to observe is due to the small fraction, but not negligible fraction, of photons that are emitted in the co-moving frame at normal angles, and we still see due to the relativistic aberration. What happens, actually? Let's see this cartoon. At early time, the red ring, we are just observing the jet is the the big black circle and with the vertical lines or horizontal lines, and we see just a small fraction of the shock front. We do not expect any polarization. We are in a perfectly symmetric situation. After a while, because gamma is decreasing, we begin to see part of the real physical boundary of the phenomenon, and we begin to see some polarization because we are receiving photons that are highly polarized from a region with a relatively high-order magnetic field. Then we see we go to the from the green ring to the blue ring and eventually to the violet or magenta green, if you like, purple, I don't know. And you see you expect a time evolution of polarization with an increase, and then when you still are in a symmetric situation, you do not see any more polarization, and then you can have again a higher polarization. But from the early phase to the later phase, you, in this specific case with this toy model, you expect a change, an abrupt change of the polarization angle by 90 degrees. A very clear and intriguing theoretical prediction. In the reality, of course, jets do not need to be homogeneous. They can be, actually. It is not probably so. It is a toy model, but it can be true or almost true in the reality. But of course, jets can show a much different structure. We speak about structure jet or Gaussian jets. Essentially, the energy is not necessarily homogeneous at the shock front, and there could be more energetic and less energetic regions. Typically, the core could be more energetic and the wings can be less energetic. Of course, the prediction of this toy model of this phenomenon changing the jet geometry, but still holds the general scenario. And we can be back to the plot produced by Elena Rossi and collaborators 15 years ago, where, as I mentioned before, we can have structure jet or homogeneous jet or Gaussian jets, and photometrically speaking, the prediction are almost indistinguishable. But in polarimetry, we can distinguish the jet geometry and test the wall scenario. If we are in a situation where the core is bright, typically the core dominates the emission at all times, all epochs, and we expect polarization that is slowly increasing. The maximum should be close to the jet break time and then decreases. Otherwise, as I mentioned before, if we have an almost homogeneous jet, we can have a lower in general polarization, but we have a maximum to maxima, actually, before and after the jet break, and the position angle is expected to change by 90 degrees. Now, before going to the observations, what could happen if the magnetic fields are not generated or not only generated locally, but are, for instance, pre-existing? There is a huge literature discussing this idea, and essentially, these works are related to the fact that it is often difficult to model a jet without involving magnetic fields that can be or are expected to be present in any case. The geometry of the magnetic fields lines are not easy to predict. We do not have, we have a good simulations showing that magnetic fields can propagate, but still we do not have a way to predict everything from first principles. So we can have toroidal magnetic fields, aligned, radial, and so on. Essentially, I'm making a complex thing simpler. We can have a scenario that is similar to the previous one, but at the early time, let's remember that when we have the afterglow, now again, let's speak about the afterglow, and then I mention something about the prompt emission. In the afterglow, we are relatively far from the progenitor, and even any large-scale order magnetic fields should have already decayed or should be not that important. And with time, this is going. This is getting more and more important. So the evolution during the late afterglow is almost unaffected. But during the early afterglow, at the beginning, you can have fairly high polarization, depending on the specific cases that we are considering, because we are seeing photons from a region with a highly ordered magnetic fields. Again, please, I don't want to cheat you. The situation can be very complicated, and in particular, if you go to the prompt emission, everything is still true. But here, for sure, magnetic fields can be important. Actually, one of the hottest topics is to understand if the gamma ray burst jets are dominated by magnetic energy, we say point in flux dominated or not, and there is the possibility where we are almost sure actually that this is true, that different gamma ray bursts can show different physical ingredients. We can also have, for instance, the case with the structure jets, where we have several, let's call mini jets, each one producing part of the prompt emission, and each one with a different magnetic fields orientation. And this means, for instance, that if you are observing the prompt emission and you integrate everything, you are possibly canceling everything out. But if you are able to do time resolver polarimetry even during the prompt emission, you can see that each pulse is different from others. And I mention only that while essentially we are rather confident about the scenario that we use to describe the afterglow, we have many we have of course problems, but essentially the scenario is able to give us predictions that can be checked, and it seems to be rather robust. Regarding the prompt emission, the best way to describe the situation is a big question mark. We are not even totally sure about the emission process. Yeah, of course, a synchrotron should be present. Anytime you have a magnetic field, you have synchrotron and relativistic acceleration. But even inverse Compton can be important. And there could also be a photospheric emission, because there are the conditions during the prompt emission to generate a sort of photosphere, and all these factors can contribute to affect the expected degree of polarization. I mentioned also, because it is something that nowadays is becoming important, although we have not been able yet to really test this idea. It's due to Kenji Toma 10 years ago or so. If you go to the radio during the afterglow, given that the polarization that we observe is supposed to be due to the geometry of the event, essentially, even in the radio, you should observe the same. However, now this can be relatively tricky, but when you have the acceleration, you have a coupling between electrons and protons at the shock front. It is not said that all the electrons should be accelerated. You can also have electrons that are described as with a thermal distribution. If this happens, you can have a Faraday rotation that could suppress the polarization. And the idea, again, let me skip the details, is that you are observing in the optical or even in high frequency in radios, in the high frequency in the Alma band, for instance, a polarization that should be essentially the same that the optical detection, a few percent or whatever. And at the lower energies, you should see a decrease, a strong decrease in polarization. And this might allow us, or anybody carrying out these observations and analysis, to estimate the fraction of the thermal electrons and provide the fundamental information for the energetics of the event. ALMA showed that to be able to carry out polarimetric observations of a gamma ray burst, but still we do not have an event with the simultaneous reliable observations to try to develop this model further. Then, let's go to the observations, and let's follow the typical time evolution of the event. And with some surprise, I guess, for somebody, we have so far a lot of polarimetric observations during the prompt emission. The technique is essentially always the same, almost always the same. It is related to the Compton scattering of high energy photons in the detectors. And given that the Compton scattering cross section depends on the polarization of the incoming photons, you might hope to observe a modulation that can be related to the linear. I never said that, but so far we have just discussing only linear polarization. I will say something about circular polarization in a few minutes, but so far we are just speaking about linear polarization. Then, as I said, you can hope to see a modulation, and actually you see very often this modulation that could be attributed to a very high polarization, linear polarization degree during the prompt phase, even close to the theoretical limits, say 60-70%. There is a very intriguing observations with integral published by Diego Gotz a few years ago, showing that for an event where a time resolved analysis could be possible, you see a rapid change of the position A. So this could be considered highly diagnostics. The problem is essentially that almost any single measurement is still not very solid statistically speaking. They are close to 3 sigma, but a little below, let's say, or in any case, this can be discussed. But more important, essentially, the problem is that, of course, a detector in space is not an ideal detector, even with Compton scattering. You have many components, and in order to rule out the possibility that the modulation you see is just due to some other effects in the satellites, in the bus, in everything that can keep the satellite operational in orbit, you would need to have performed accurate calibrations before launch. This was not done in the past because it was not considered this possibility, and it is done recently with the other instruments like Polar, that published polarization for a few gamma ray bursts a couple of years ago. And what we see with the better calibrated instruments that the time integrated polarization level during the prompt emission is typically low, if any. It can be consistent with zero in most cases, or in any case, it is not very high, 20-30%. Of course, it's high in astrophysical sense, but it is very far from the theoretical limit. But even more important, in this case, it is a confirmation. In one event or a couple of events, when time-resolved polarimetry during the prompt emission, of course, when you go to the prompt emission, you are working with high energy photons. And for any astrophysical spectrum that you can consider, going to high energy, you imply that you have less photons, and therefore statistics is weaker. In any case, for those few events where you can carry out time-resolved polarimetry, you see very clearly an important change of the position. And this seems to be a relatively solid observation. That said, while the change in position angle immediately implies that we are not seeing an emission from a region with a highly ordered magnetic
Stefano,
yes,
5 minutes.
Okay, I'm going to the end. But maybe 10 minutes, can I have? Well, anyway. And if this happens, essentially, we have evidence for a highly structured jets, at least at the very beginning. However, it is still possible that we see events, and these events can show different physical ingredients, as I mentioned before. Probably the best way for the prompt emission to derive stronger inferences could be with a statistical analysis. Essentially, you need to observe 100 or so events, and then from the statistical distribution of the polarization, possibly time resolved, that you observe, you can say which is the most promising scenario to explain everything. There are plans to do that with the future satellites. If we go to the early afterglow, and observing the early afterglow, I mean during the first few minutes, so you need the robotic telescopes and a very rapid reaction. We see some of the most amazing results ever obtained in polarimetry. For instance, there is one case where the polarization is observed very high at 15% 2 or 3 minutes after the event, slowly decaying with time with a stable position angle. This is very important. From one side, it shows that you have a order magnetic fields. This is the only way to have this high polarization with stable position angle. And I have to introduce a concept typical of this of the shocks forming gamma ray burst. If you are observing the early afterglow, very often you are observing something that we call the reverse shock. If you have the afterglow, the shock front, and you have the forward shock propagating in the interstellar medium, in the circumburst medium, you can also have a bouncing back shock that is crossing the outflow and is experiencing, let's say, the physical conditions of the prompt emission. So in this case, at least, we are sure there is a large scale order magnetic fields, and this event is magnetically dominated, essentially. But there are also other gamma ray burst where we don't see that. The few but reliable early time measurements are also showing cases where we have no polarization at all. So again, we have evidence that gamma ray bursts are not all the same, or essentially when some process dominates or not can be different considering different events. If we go to the late afterglow, the situation is much better established. We have many observations. They are listed in several papers, if you like. And apart from one case that is still highly debated, still coming from 2003, essentially the polarization level is close to 1-3%. And in a few cases, although with great difficulties, because of course the sketch that I showed you before show a well-behaving afterglow with a smooth decay, but this is not always the case, we were able to detect the amazing 90 degrees rotation of the position angle. I show you here two plots. One on the right is a gamma ray burst of 2002 with a paper led by Davide Lazzati. And essentially, we have here a case where the position angle is roughly constant during the evolution, before and after the jet break. That was a typical case when we have a gamma ray burst afterglow with a very smooth light curve. On the left, actually, this is published by Klaasi Bjelsma and us, of course, in 2012, we have a very complex polarimetric curve with You see, in particular, after the jet break, after the break time, we see a strong variation of polarization degree. But if you look at the position angle, you see a clearly, a rather clear, at least, a 90 degrees rotation. So that means that at least in a few cases, although if the process is affected by many irregularities that are expected in the real world, a description with a roughly homogeneous jet can work. I mentioned going to the end that a few years ago, again with the class, we detected one more event with a 90 degrees rotation of the position angle, but quite unexpectedly, we also detect circular polarization at a low level, close to 0.1, 0.2%, but paradoxically, measuring circular polarization can be easier than measuring linear polarization. The percentage is a higher, sorry. What I was saying is that, theoretically speaking, you expect that circular polarization should be only a fraction, 10-15% of the linear polarization that you are measuring. And this case is much, much higher than the expectations. As Lara Nava showed in a paper and collaborators in 2016, at present there is no way to explain this detection. We are also wondering if it could be to some instrumental artifact, because this is a very delicate observation, but so far we can only confirm the observations. Actually, physics is not totally the same, of course, but even in some circular polarization, it is observed also in the emission of several quasars. Again, however, as you can see with the yellow symbol, bigger yellow symbol, we see a circular polarization that is much higher. I would say substantially higher, but we can discuss about it, compared to what we see in something that could be partly similar in quasar. So this is still an open problem. There are ideas, very highly anisotropic distribution of the electrons and so on, but I don't mention it now. And last slide, so I hope I'm keeping this talk within the limits. Independently almost of the physics of gamma ray burst, observing polarization for cosmological sources allows us to have an amazing possible test of Lorentz invariance. Essentially, what if you compare the polarization at two different energies, going to the higher energies, if the photons are emitted from cosmological distance, there should be a sort of birefringence of the space, and essentially, this what happens is that you are canceling polarization. In principle, you should not observe any polarization from any, you should observe no polarization for sources at cosmological distance. Given that we observe some polarization, although you can discuss if the detection so far of the polarization at high energies are reliable, this means that you can put limits on quantum gravity effects. And these limits are getting stronger and stronger. There are ways, of course, theoreticians are smart to overcome these difficulties, but from the observations, it's appeared to be beginning to be difficult to have Lorentz invariance effect, at least in a large family of quantum loop gravities or other alternative theories of gravities where you expect some birefringence of the medium of the universe. Then, this is all. I hope to have at least interested you, showing how many things can be learned, although with difficulties, from polarimetric measurements, at least in the specific case of gamma ray burst astrophysics, where Polarimetry is considered one of the most important diagnostic tools. And if there are questions, I'm available, if I can, to try to reply. Thank you to all of you.